5 kilograms, which puts it in the small category. And interestingly, it will have an endurance of up to 2 hours, and its surveillance range will be up to about 20 kilometers. So depending on the sensor that we have being carried, you'll be able to see a variety of different ground targets. The aircraft is used in surveillance operations and reconnaissance, so it has a military use, and is currently in operation in Portugal.
We might be asking you to do that all over again, because I'm not entirely certain you're going out, Ian. So that was a good rehearsal. If you are, ladies and gentlemen, if you did hear all that, you might even hear it all over again. But very faintly, yes. Well, there we go. Well, I'm sure we'd be able to sort that out, playing with the wiggly amps down below. You were talking, I mean, the ability to have these vehicles for military reconnaissance and aerial systems, all sorts of things, surveillance, intelligence gathering.
Yeah, the types of things that we'd be looking at is the sort of payloads would be an electro-optic or an infrared payload, and that might weigh about a kilogram of the all-up weight of the aircraft being at 5 kilograms. And it's as I mentioned earlier, it is a relatively small UAV with a wingspan of about 180 centimeters, which of course, if you're operating in the UK, would be one would need to be within visual line of sight, which with an aircraft this size does make it quite limited to be able to see.
So rules and regulations are different all over the world, aren't they? Of different sort of
they are indeed.
Authorities.
Yes, the within the UK, the regulations would require you to be operating no higher than 400 feet. For a small UAV, no more than 400 feet.
So we don't need the 7,000 feet today then from...
Not quite, no.
No, okay.
We can operate down to very, very low minimums.
So this one was just launched, just thrown into the air, but you've got UAVs, you use catapult launches and, you know, all sorts, isn't it? I suppose, is that depending on what sort of headwind you're launching into?
It could be the sort of the headwind would be an effect. It's also going to be the sort of payload you're looking at, and how far you're wanting to go. Because if you're taking off from the ground, you're going to need a lot more power to get it to lift.
More oomph.
And really to get it away from the ground, or you need a much more powerful motor. So this one, if you have a small motor in it, you're able to cruise much better, you don't need as much fuel, and you're able to get more efficiency from the battery power that is going to power the motor.
I guess weight is absolutely critical. Every little component is taking away performance, like we do in big aeroplanes.
That's
but
right.
The percent is even greater, isn't it?
Yes, the effect of weight on an aircraft, not only for just pure performance, but it determines which category of unmanned aircraft you fall into. So there is a category which is 7.5 kilos to 20 kilos, which this aircraft is just slightly under that, so you're actually in the small unmanned air systems category.
This one's what, 5 kilos? So what, 5 bags of sugar?
Yes, that's right. It's going to be very light, and it's the. But lots of the rules are at the moment determined by the amount of kinetic energy that the aircraft will have, and so at 5 kilos, good old mv squared would be or half mv squared.
Half.
And that would so if you can keep your weight down, you have a lot less kinetic energy.
And that means what you hit is less of a thump.
That's right. Just a small headache rather than a
yes.
Gold whack.
Yes. Yes. How big the thump, yes.
How big the dent in your car is.
So the best way, if we can't find him, is look at the screen and then look where the camera's pointing, and then you'll find the UAV.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. So we just see him turning a very, very slow turn. He's gaining some height there. And typically when you're at this sort of altitude, you'd be getting, with a normal sensor payload, you'd be getting a brilliant view of the ground, and you could be streaming. Oh, and there we go. So we're coming in. So this particular aircraft, it comes down on a parachute, which would cushion the landing. So it protects the aircraft, protects the payload. And as you can actually see, it actually takes the parachute out of the front of the nose. So just in case it comes down nose first. Oh, we've got a catch.
Slick. Oh,
congratulations.
That could hurt, couldn't it? I mean, five bags of sugar landing on your wrist. Yeah.
Got to be careful.
And so now out on the runway is another one. Which one's your one?
This one is Spotter. This is from Southampton University. So they've currently developed this aircraft as a development aircraft for surveillance. And it's they've used some really new manufacturing techniques. So it's 3D printed, which is a novel approach to aircraft manufacturing, and currently made mainly from polymers. But 3D printing allows you to get very complex shapes and achieve a much more lightweight structure from a relatively simple material.
There's such a different range in different UAVs. Are they all aimed for different markets or different things, or is it just still developing into what is going to be the optimum type?
It's usually the sort of the passion of the designer. What do they want to be able to achieve? So different planforms will determine the types of payload one can carry. So this one with a payload slung underneath, and that will have various different detectors that could have in there. So you could have an infrared detector, or perhaps even a signal intelligence payload. So you'd actually be listening out to radio and communications data. And this particular aircraft, because it is made out of a 3D printed polymer, would actually allow the aircraft to carry a much heavier payload for the engine size that it carries.
Did you say this has been printed?
Yes.
Out of a desk printer, well, not my normal desk printer,
no.
But so that you could just replace parts by just pressing print and you get another part exactly
correct,
like the original.
Yes, it's the and you can change the design very easily so that you can run a print off the redesign a part, reprint it, and it's much, much cheaper to manufacture using 3D printing. And it allows you, the supply chain for parts is much more simple, because actually all you need to do is carry a bag of powder and a printer, and as long as you have access to the drawings, you could print a new part if you break something. So
as the distributor, that means you're not going to make money when someone needs a new part. Because
didn't necessarily say that.
Because they're going to print, you know, I want a couple of spare wings, I'll just print another here.
It's the, I'm sure somebody will make some money somewhere.
Oh, I'm sure someone will. Oh, yes. I have no doubt about that.
But in terms of being able to support aircraft, it makes it much more simple to support. So therefore, the volumes could increase. So therefore, you could have... actor ready, the pilot's got to be ready, and you have to have tension in the huge elastic band that it runs off.
I can feel the tension mounting. We haven't seen this fly this week yet at Farnborough.
So, and this particular aircraft is a very special one because it's made using graphene. And I have to say, I had to do a quick search of what graphene is.
Do you know? I think I know. Isn't that, if you use a pencil on a piece of paper, that leaves a sort of a very thin, it's one,
yes,
one cell, one sort of atom or something. It's very, very thin, very, very strong and flexible, isn't it?
That's right. Well, Billy, who's out there at the moment, he showed me a piece of graphene, and it is one atom thick.
That's it.
And
yeah,
it was it's incredible. And of course, the category that type of material means that you can build things incredibly small. So he said it's the smallest two-dimensional shape you'll ever see. It's one atom thick.
Crikey.
And
very, very strong, isn't it? Even that thing's, I mean, I was talking to them, and it's a lot, lot stronger than steel. It's not 20 times stronger. It's considerable. It's 200 times stronger than steel
and
light.
And tougher than diamond.
Yep.
And it conducts electricity, which is another key point to it. So hence, we're just getting ready for the launch now.
You know, we could have done with the commentary box made of prosperine on Wednesday. We're in a lightning strike in this very position.
That's right. We'd have wanted it then.
Yep.
That was exciting.
I'll tell you what, our dear cameraman out on the right found it a lot more exciting than anybody else because he didn't have curly hair before that lightning strike, which was right where we're sitting. That was a very dramatic moment in the show. Didn't see it in the flying program, but wow, when it arrived, we fried half the stuff up here in the commentary. There it is.
There
launched.
We go. We're off the ground. So, as we can see, this aircraft is electrically powered as well. So it's actually a very simple design that we've actually got here, but the material it's made from is what is being demonstrated here. And often, a lot in aerospace, it's not until you actually create an aircraft that gets off the ground that you actually appreciate how materials can be developed. And so what you're seeing here is very special, and it's right at the cutting edge of aerospace technology in terms of the materials that are involved. The wing, being made of graphene, it will conduct electricity very, really efficiently. And so it could be developed further into being a solar panel as being part of the structure of the wing. And as graphene is adopted more within the aerospace industry in terms of the materials for structures, you'll see them getting lighter. They'll be increasingly resistant to lightning strikes, and it'll be it'll just make things the age of electrically powered aircraft will be that much closer, because the batteries that would be used will become more efficient and will allow for greater range. But what we're seeing at the moment is right at the early stages of materials development. Yes, as we were just talking about earlier, the graphene is 200 times stronger than steel. So yes, it's the it is a very strong piece of structure, and it's built into the structure of the aircraft.
So what got you into UAVs?
Yes, an interesting one.
Oh, okay.
I started in aerospace. I've been in aerospace for almost 30 years now, but in particular, unmanned was when I joined a particular company that we were operating an unmanned aircraft as a service. That was quite a radical approach, and has been adopted throughout the world in various contexts, and mostly military. But we'll see it increasingly adopted around the world. I know Amazon keep talking about delivering things by unmanned. I'm not convinced by that just yet. Just yet.
That's the thing. Just yet is where we're going to be in the future.
When they can land on my lawn, I'll be impressed.
Have you got a lawn?
Oh, yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes, if I lived in a block of flats, I'd be slightly more sceptical.
Yes.
Yes, when I was talking to Billy a little earlier, we talked about the use of graphene, and his commentary was mainly around use of graphene as integrated as part of a carbon fiber structure. We're right at the beginning of seeing this type of technology being adopted within aerospace. So, as I mentioned earlier, this is really early days. This is new piece of technology. And there we go. We're going for a low pass. There we go. Oh, we're coming into a nice stall. Not sure if we meant to do that. Anyway, we're coming for a nice gentle landing. There we go. Oh, and we're down. Everything looks intact. And of course, this aircraft will now need to be recovered.
Yeah, indeed.
Oh,
yes.
And what I see also from the edge of the runway, we have Robird. I think this is the one we've all been waiting for. It's the ta-da. So yes, Robird is a robotic bird. And the question was asked earlier, what is an ornithopter? And an ornithopter is a mechanically flying bird. So I think I've had people commentating before that says, or come to me and say, oh, somebody's let a bird go on the runway. Well, that isn't a bird. That is an unmanned aircraft.
I mean, it is exactly like a bird of prey flapping around. I mean, it looks like a... Crikey, let me think. It's a falcon of some sort. Peregrine falcon, something
correct.
Like that?
Okay. A peregrine falcon, yes. Yeah. And that with the Clear Flight Solutions have a number of different designs for this particular aircraft, and they're painted in different colours to have different species of falcon. But they are also working on a further development of this. It'll be the same fundamental design, but it'll be in the shape of a bald eagle, and that will have a 2.2-metre wingspan.
Is that for the American market?
It's for cheeky birds. Cheeky birds who aren't scared by peregrine falcons. So we'll look and take on seagulls and things like that with that one.
I mean, the mechanics to flap and fly around like that, that's going to take an awful lot of clever design.
Yes. I'd invite you to come along and see us at our stand after the display, because we have a number of them on display. And it flaps. The wing, you have to see the wing to appreciate it. The wing goes up and down, and it flexes along the length of the wing, but it also flexes forward to back. And so that creates both lift and thrust, which is just phenomenal, I'd say, from a sort of a linear structure. There is no other propulsion on here at the moment. You see it gliding, and you see the glide angle it's got there. This is immensely efficient. And Clear Flight Solutions, when they developed the Robird, they took a number of real falcons, and they produced some three-dimensional photos of a real falcon, so that they get the profile of the head, the body, the wings absolutely right, and that's why it looks so realistic, and why it's so efficient when it flies. And as you can see now, Ramon is flying downwind, and we're looking at a fair old breeze today.
Is that the name of the bird?
No, Ramon is the pilot.
Ah, has the bird got a name?
Oh, this particular bird is called Jana.
Jana.
Yes.
Why?
They're all named after famous women in aviation. So we can see on our stand, we also have Amelia.
Ah, okay. We've got one in the commentary box that we've been trying to feed, but it hasn't been very successful. This one, what's this one called?
That one, I can't remember her
you
name.
You can't remember her name?
They are all women.
No, what? Well, there we go. No wonder it's looking the other way from me.
She'll peck your eyes out later.
Crikey, I've got a bird in the commentary box that's not speaking to me already.
Didn't take you long.
Those of you on the big screen are probably having a look at this. So this bird, it's an amazing bit of kit, it really
oh
is.
Oh yes. So there we go. That's what it looks
there
like.
Oh, there we go. Ow. It bit me.
So it's and as you can see, the fuselage, I'll call it, or the body, is made from, that's again 3D printed. Then the wings are made from expanded polypropylene, and it's but it has very specific pieces of strengthening in there to give the flexibility both in their length and across the cord, and the tail fin is made from a carbon fiber composite as well, and it's powered by a single motor, and the battery in it is a it will give us 10 minutes of flight time, which, to be honest, when you're wanting to clear birds, is long enough really to be able to clear birds from a specific area. Because what we're looking to do is actually to properly appeal to their primary instincts of survival. So we're not just trying to scare them to make them run away or fly away. What we're actually looking to do is to get them convinced they're going to be eaten. And if they're getting eaten, birds don't want that.
Not a bad score. Ian, thank you very much for coming up and
thank
joining
you so
us.
Are
you going to come back in the public days?
I'm afraid we're not.
You're
this
not.
Is our last day.
Ah, okay.
Roadbird has flown for the last time here.
Well, it's been great.
But we'll be back for another farmer, believe me.
Fantastic. All right, thank you very much. Thank the guys for putting up with the terrible weather that we've had.
Oh, and, yes, it's been exciting,
I have to say. Certainly, that's one word for it.
But we did fly in the rain.
Yes, you did.
We were very pleased about that.
Thanks, Ian.
Thank you.
Display would not be able to go ahead. If you give me a moment, I'm going to confer with my colleagues over at the drop zone there, Corporal Stephen Handley and Private Ivan Jacobs, and I'll let you know whether this afternoon's display is going to happen. Okay, so what's happening now then is they're flying around, they're seeing where the wind drift indicators land, and they're plotting on their air photograph on whether it lands within a kilometer radius. They're also checking each other's equipment, checking each other's parachutes, making sure they are ready to safely exit the aircraft. At the same time, they're climbing to a height of around 3,500 feet to commence today's display. Okay, if you keep looking at the aircraft then, what we're looking for is a trail of red smoke coming from the aircraft. Do not be alarmed, this is not an emergency, this is supposed to be there. This is just merely a display, an indication that the display is going to commence shortly. As you can see, the conditions are cloudy today. What they're trying to do is find a gap in the clouds to safely exit the aircraft. They're circling round again. While they're doing that, I'll tell you a little about the team. The Red Devils were formed in 1964 and became the Army's official free-fall display team in 1979. We're made up of 13 members, which are all serving paratroopers within the 1st, 2nd or 3rd Battalion, the Parachute Regiment. All members of the team, before they come to the team, have to serve a minimum of 3 years in their parent unit and have to have served an operational tour in theatres such as Iraq, Afghanistan, etc. Okay, if you keep looking skyward towards the aircraft, then they're bringing it around again, trying to find that gap for us. And there you can see the red smoke trailing from the aircraft. This is indication that the jump master is about to exit the plane. And there he is, first jumper away, quickly reaching speeds in excess of 100 miles per hour. Pulling his parachute, which is safely deployed. We have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 jumpers safely out of the aircraft. Okay, the first canopy there, the white canopy, that's the team's jump master. What he's doing is assessing the wind conditions, and he's going to set the pattern, the landing pattern, for the rest of the skydivers to follow. He's flying around now, he's pulling on his steering toggles, left to go left, right to go right. He's going to set himself up for his final turn. And can we have a big round of applause for Lance Corporal Lee Crutchington. Followed down by our team cameraman, Lance Corporal Ian Kane. Okay, if you keep looking skyward then, you can see the flags thrown by one of our sponsors, Chemring Group, who are responsible for the red smoke that you see today. I'd like to say a large thank you to them. We're also proudly flying the flags of the Parachute Regiment and our 2,000 square foot Union flag flown by Corporal Mike French. Mike French is just coming in for his final approach now. And there he is, safely down, followed in by Lance Corporal Alex Littleburn with a Parachute Regiment flag. Thank you, that's all jumpers safely down on the ground. I'd like to thank you for coming and watching this afternoon. Finally, I'd like to say a thank you to our newest sponsor, who have a stand in the hall today, Ops Corps. They provided some of the team's helmets for us. Okay, if you like what you saw, if you have any good images, please share them with us on our social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We'd be happy to share them images and put them on our Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter. Thank you. Thanks for watching. Finally, finish with a good big round of applause for the jumpers today, the Parachute Regiment, Red Devils.
Gaz, thank you very much indeed. When you do your outbrief, please thank the team for dropping in, literally, into Farnborough. Obviously, the team just have to pick up their canopies because we don't want the 380 to start the takeoff run. Getting quite close to the canopies, you could actually inflate them all over again. So in a few minutes, we'll be starting the main sort of show with the big aircraft. Show sponsored by Accenture. Providing aerospace defense industry solutions. So let's go down the batting order of the rest of the day so you can make note of the aircraft you particularly want to look at. The next one is sitting out at the end of the runway. Pretty obvious which it is. It is the Airbus A380. After him we will have the A350, then the Airbus A400, taking us up to 2 o'clock. Then for the first time for many, many years here at Farnborough, we have an auto gyro just after 2 o'clock. Those of you who pay attention, which of course is everybody, will notice that the A350, having done his display, will actually fly away. Well, he will come back for a flypast, being escorted by the Royal Air Force aerobatic team, the Red Arrows. So the 350 and the Red Arrows will fly past. I will be able to find you from which way they are coming later. I'll give you plenty of warning on that. Then we have at 22 minutes past two, the Lockheed Electra. Then another touring item coming in from RAF Fairford, the F-35. Running up just after 2:45, we have the Pitts, followed by the Wing Walkers on the hour of 3 o'clock. Then Build a Plane will be displaying at around about 3:15. Starduster, which we got airborne earlier, we're coming to some very pretty aerobatics, taking us up to 3:30. After that, just after Starduster, Spitfire takeoff. I won't talk over the noise of the Spitfire taking off, and I know you'll probably appreciate that. Then we have the Apache. 33 minutes past, and indeed, the rest station in the start takeoff run now is from Airbus A380. This is a dramatic display, very impressive display from this very large aircraft.
around where the 350 is about now. So we've got different landing spots and thresholds. Doesn't matter if you go beyond that, that's fine. And here comes the A350 XWB, extra wide body. 380 will go to the far end of the runway, turn around, taxi back up to the far right, and we push back into its parking slot. Airborne for an equally dramatic display is the 350. Earlier this week, Sir Richard Branson was here on Monday, along with the Right Honourable then Prime Minister David Cameron, and Richard Branson announced an order of 8 Airbus A350-1000s. Now, this XWB one you see, this is MSN2, powered by two Rolls-Royce Trent XWB turbofans. Incidentally, on the Rolls-Royce stand, you can have a very close look at these engines with 84,000 pounds of thrust at takeoff. This is MSN2, one of the original 5 certification development aircraft, first to be equipped with a full cabin interior. Now, in a 3-class configuration, the A350-900 will seat 325 passengers. And there is a longer-range version of the 350, the 350-900, called the Ultra Long Range. It's also being developed and has the capability of flying up to 19 hours. And what does that mean in real sense? Well, it means the Singapore Airlines have already ordered the aircraft, and they're going to use it to restart the Los Angeles and New York direct service to Singapore. There's a longer fuselage version, the type that Richard Branson has ordered. This is the 350-1000. That will typically seat 366 passengers. And the first one has already been put together and being fitted out now down in Toulouse in the south of France. The maiden flight will take place before the end of this year. So far, orders for the 350 XWB, 802 orders from 42 customers. That was at the end of last month. Deliveries of the 350 at the end of last month. Well, Airbus have managed to deliver 27 of the aircraft, the A350-900s, to 6 operators. ~53% of it is composites. Two new Rolls-Royce Trent XWB engines, which power the aircraft, generate 25% lower CO2 emissions than previous types. 25% less fuel burn, 25% less operating costs. That's a good number for an accountant. ~380 coming back from our left. He's going to be coupled up to the tug and then put back into his parking slot. As the 350 continues its fly past. There's a request for the white van, SHB white van, number 38, sitting on the apron. White van with a yellow flashing on the top. I don't suppose you can hear us, you just close your door, but could you move? You're right in the middle of our camera shot. Go on, shift it. Throw stones at him. We'll try another method. So the gear coming down on the 350. We'll use another method to see if number 38 van in the way would move. Oh, it's likely to be joined by another mate. Cool. So the 350 turning base, he's not going to be landing. Obviously the 380 is there because he's going to depart briefly to join up with the Red Arrows for coming back later. This white man is right in the middle of all the camera shots. I'm going to send my producer out to have a word. See if he gets there without being shot for breaking the barrier. Probably breaking all sorts of rules now. Mark's not wearing a Dayglow jacket. But there we go, the 350 coming past. Oh, there's a Reggie spotter as well as taking photographs. A400. On the runway, about to start his takeoff run. In fact, brakes are just coming off, perhaps, on the 400, or he's just drifting forward to the beginning of the takeoff position. Go on, Mark. Get over the fence. Go on. No one's watching. No one's going to know. Be careful on that bit. It's painful. Give us a wave, Mark, for the camera. A400 now starting the takeoff run. This is Atlas. This is the military airlifter from Airbus. Medium-sized multi-role transporter took really in fruition in December 09. First seen here in 2010. Well done, Mark. Use you as a bird scarer soon. Actually, the programme for this aircraft, the A400M Atlas, originated with the European Future Large Aircraft requirement way back in 1992, supported by the nations of Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, Portugal, Spain and Turkey. Long evaluation phase. Beginning of the construction started the first aircraft in January 05. Maiden flight, December 06. That flight test program amassed some 5,665 hours. It's already received its full civil and military certifications. Designed for the carriage of troops and oversized cargoes included armored vehicles and helicopters. The ability to undertake tactical delivery operations from unprepared strips was of significant importance. In other words, it can land on really rough, short, narrow strips. It can then use those huge propellers to reverse down the strip, get rid of its load, take off without having to do any U-turns on the runway, and therefore minimize the time on the ground, and therefore greater efficiency of delivering whatever it is you wish to deliver. The engines are the Europrop International, rated at 13,000 shaft horsepower. Now those propellers in reverse pitch those props can reverse the aircraft up a 2-degree concrete slope at max takeoff weight, reversing. If you look at the big screen, you can see the scaffolding pole just ahead of the flight deck. That's the in-flight refueling probe. Talking about those big propellers, the adjacent propellers on each wing rotate in opposite directions to produce down between the engine's airflow. Now, the major benefits of this are reduced wing loading, more symmetrical airflow, greater lift distribution, and improved engine out handling. And indeed, that whole method, that whole concept, adds to 4% of lift. Crew of two, NVG, night vision goggle capability. Head-up display, big head-up display. Also got a third seat for the tactical mission commander, if you so wish, and you've got the loadmaster station down in the cargo area. Quite right. In terms of cargo, the A400M can carry armoured vehicles, things like the M113 or the Warrior, helicopters where you can stick in the back, Super Puma, a couple of Apaches, Tiger gunship, not all at the same time, they'd all fight. Up to 116 fully knitted, fully kitted troops can be transported on sidewall and removable centerline seats. Oh, I suppose YouTube, I'm in for it now. In the medical role, the type can carry 66 stretchers and 25 medical staff. And it can cruise around about 300 knots. It's got a great rate of climb. It's very versatile, very flexible, as you can see. Diving steep to the ground. Side stick flying controls, all by fly-by-wire. Depending on what you're going to do with the aircraft, the A400M is expected to have a minimum service life of 30,000 hours, even taking into account the roughness that you get on low-level operations, short field deployment. Reckon that the export market over the next 25 years will account for something like 400 of this type of airlifter. Most recent order placed by Malaysia, who require 4 aircraft with air-to-air refueling capability. Current production rate, which will be stepped up as required. Production rate for Atlas is around 2.5 aircraft per month. Airdrop operations can be conducted anywhere between 125 knots and 200 knots. Depends on how long you want to stay in the hot zone, I suppose, really, isn't it? Twenty-two of these type of aircraft are operated in the United Kingdom or on order. First one, I think, came a couple of years ago, November 14. Deep approach, let's have a look at the runway lights. Yes, they're out. That means that he is positioning for a landing. It'll be a very short landing using the reverse pitch propellers. We get a little bit of reversing, I think, or maybe a 360-degree turn on the runway. Just depends on the layout of the taxiways for after landing to what he's going to do. The A350 is floating around, joining up with the Red Arrows, of which we're expecting that flypass to be from your left to your right of the 350 with the Red Arrows, but I will confirm that once I get them in sight, but that's the plan, I believe. A400M just touching down. You can hear the reverse pitch props coming in. There they go. And reversing down the runway at quite a good speed, actually. That's quite a good rate. When you're reversing an airliner like this, or an aircraft like this, what you don't do when you want to come to a halt is put your feet on the brakes, because you normally smack the tail in the ground. So you actually have to go into forward thrust to come to a halt. And as long as your nose wheel's on the centre line of the runway, you can't get too wrong and run off into the wet. And I guess sometimes the load master's leaning out the back and saying à droite and la gauche, or à gauche, which is one is left and right, or the other way around. So the 350 we can see that is definitely holding out towards the left over Laffin's Plain, almost heading down towards Odium at the moment, which is only about 8 miles away. Incidentally, when we had our horrendous rain on Monday of 21.2 millimetres, Odium had 0.1. Not fair. Doing a 180 degree turn on the runway. The stickers you got down the back end of the fuselage, the yellow checkered stickers, that's all part of flight test programs. They can see where stress points are, it's all for data gathering, and that's all to do with the testing. That's not normally on a current production aircraft. You can see that it's a test machine. So we're tracking the 350 at the moment, down in the Odium area. So tracking the 350s down to the southwest, looks like potentially lining up towards you, watching him holding currently at 1700 feet, doing 295 knots and heading certainly our direction. And as I say that, it looks like he's just turned away again. There we go. And Mark, you've seen the reds somewhere, have you?
I have. They were further south. I think they've turned out towards the west. No, you can see them running in behind the 350 for those of you that can see the aircraft to the left.
They're looking on the big screens, if you're near a big screen, with the camera work that we've got, looking a long way down towards Laffin's Plain. We can see the reds just tucking in to the 350. Final checks be done, final calls, speed adjustments. I understand we get one flyby only left to right of the 350 with the reds. 350 will then break off, come into land, then the reds will come back to land here at Farnborough. two sections of the Red Arrow is now closing up on the 350. Those eagle-wide ones of you, and Ian, the director of One Box Television, has already spotted it, the fact there are 10 hawks there. Well, they go around in 10, so you've always got a spare, but it also brings the manager or the commentator in to the shows, and it's always useful to have a spare hawk. So I think probably the number 10 won't necessarily be in the formation, but he might be a bit higher taking photographs, or indeed he might tuck in himself. I suspect from this orbit they must really soon be all on board. My trackers stopped tracking. Gyrocopter airborne. So while we'll just do a quick flip to hold off the Reds and the 350. This is from Total Calidus, the auto gyro. It's a long time since we've had an auto gyro here. Long time since auto gyro displayed at Farmers. Very light, max takeoff weight around about 500 kilos, tandem two-seat aircraft designed in Germany in 2009. Corkscrew along the A axis. It's the smoke assist is intentional, by the way. Flying speeds auto gyro anywhere between an 0 and 120 miles an hour. That rotor on the top is not driven at all. It's the wind going up through the rotor blade that's turning it. So you're always in auto rotation. Those who fly helicopters will understand that. The air going up through the blade is forcing it to turn, which is giving you the lift. Flat 360 degree rudder turns. Great safe flight envelope. And it's really just that blast of speed. Auto gyros, in a sense, cannot stall. Sponsored by Air Total and Sydney Charles Insurance. Other sponsors, Pooley's Pilot Supplies, Sky Demon Navigation Software, and Vertigo Aircraft Covers. Auto gyro has been seen in the United Kingdom, in France, and in Germany. Cheap to run, 12 to 18 litres per hour. And if you're cracking along at about 100 miles an hour, something like that, that's quite good. It's a propeller at the back, the pusher propeller, so it's a proper propeller. Pushes the aircraft forward in flight. That's why you get that rotor disc slightly inclined back. That's how you start the takeoff run, certainly. Certainly getting a closer look of this aircraft than you do with some of the other aircraft that have to display a bit further away from us. The sequence you're seeing is not really a set sequence, it's just tailored to suit each event and wherever it is. And there's a sort of a showing the agility of the auto gyro. Peter Davis. Flying for 35 years, gyro planes for 22 years, so he knows what he's doing. He's achieved the first gold Calibri, first gold to be awarded in the world for achievements in microlights. Came fourth himself in the first World Microlight Championships, winning the speed event outright. Set a couple of world distance records. He won the 1994 Around the World Air Race. Barrel dive, his first time, First time we've seen the Auto Gyro here. We haven't had it for the rest of the week, so this is new to me as well. They're great fun to fly. I had a happy afternoon flying an Auto Gyro in Kent. I think it was last year. There must be a description to this manoeuvre. I'm told it's the combination roll. Well, crikey, that is really chucking it about. Wow. Which James Bond movie had the Auto Gyro in? Little Nelly.
Little Nelly.
But which one?
It was a Connery film, wasn't it?
We're getting votes. You know, both my talkback ears. We're getting all sorts of suggestions.
Leave it with me. I'm going to look that one up.
Thought you might. Pilot's waving. If you ever see you waving back, shows how you can hands off. He's either that or he's cold and he's trying to warm his hands up.
Would you like the answer now?
You all right?
You only live twice.
Ah, okay. I think you'd agree, it's a remarkably agile aircraft. Quite cheap to run and operate. Certain amount of changing around, going in the competitive position. Coming in round for quite a steep, neat little approach for a very short landing. Plop it on the ground. Hardly any landing run required at all. Now got the clear. The tracker has turned itself off, otherwise I'll be able to tell you where the A350 is. Orbiting round to our southwest. We're just going to have a little look at it. Let's have a look at what we've got while the Auto Gyro taxis off the runway. So we've got the 350 and the Red Arrows to fly by. They both got to land. Well, not both. When I say 11 of them have got to land. Then in about 10 minutes' time, we're looking for the Lockheed Electra. Then at 35 minutes past two, a touring item, the F-35. And for that, they'll have your own specialist commentator. Then we'll have the Pitts, the Wing Walker, Build a Plane, Starduster, the Apache, Spitfire, Typhoon, Global Stars, the Great War Display Team, the Dornier 328, the Boeing 727, the Blades in formation with the 727, and the P-8 Poseidon. Now lining up to run past, single fly pass from your left. This year is a centenary for Boeing, and indeed it's today, 100 years old today. So happy birthday, Boeing, and this is the salute from Airbus for your birthday, from Airbus to Boeing with the Royal Air Force Aerobatic Team, the Red Arrows. Happy birthday, Boeing. 10 behind us taking a photo shot of that flyby. And I understand that we're going to have the Red Arrows landing on first, and then the 350 after that. You look to your right, over the black sheds, running in is, rather, the Red Arrows to break and then come into land. Lights on. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's always quite difficult recovering multiple aircraft to an airfield. So what they've done by flying down the runway in formation, and they break at a specific time period, probably a second, second and a half, something like that, means that they do the same break, same G-force, same pull around the corner, just to the tickle on that break. It's quite a hard break. Actually, I've been in with the Red Arrows without a G-suit when we've done that, and it is painful for a civvy. But it means they've got equal spacing, more or less, all the way down the runway. And that means you should be able to get them streamlined in. Now, you're also going to occasionally see a little puff of smoke, maybe, from one or two or three of them. That's if they come across any turbulence on the approach, and occasionally just put a little bit of wind drift down. So it's like having your own windsock out on the threshold. But if they hit a little bit of turbulence or turbulence from the guy ahead, they just pop a little bit of smoke. And you also see some are higher and lower than the others. So The one, there's a bit of smoke, he's just got the, that's for the wind drift, so there's a portable mobile, windsock on the runway. What you don't want to do is fly through other guys' wake turbulence. So therefore you stagger it slightly, and therefore the wake turbulence will be in a slightly different position. That's the theory. The practice takes a little bit more practice. But these guys can do it, each hawk coming down, quite a pump when he lands with a hawk, put it on the ground, don't muck about. And they'll also be landing left and right of the centre line as well, keeping the centre line clear, that if one of them decides, even touching down, that he's had enough and he wants to go around, he can whisk through, quite standard for the rest of them, between them, and get airborne again, and come around and have another go. Straight down the lattice plane, straight into the council land at the end of the runway, in the canal, which is clear of people, and be on the Daily Mail. They're just waiting for the reds to clear, and I don't know whether they will eventually end up on the south side down by the commentary position parked, but I think they're going to probably go around the tag area around the corner and then come back down this end. Not entirely certain how they're going to get over here, but I can see the chocks are all laid out and the blues, the engineers, are already getting into position to receive the reds when they come back, or they might be turning on the runway. No, they're on the taxiway. We had the International Rocketry Challenge taking place here this morning at Farnborough. I know that we managed to film a bit of it, and on the big screens we're soon going to show you a little video of what went on this morning of the Rocketry Challenge, and we'll indeed be able to give you some of the results. And in fact, my mate Michael Underwood was down there to see the action. Michael's going to be on stage on Saturday and Sunday here, and I'm no doubt he'll tell you more about it then. I think if we might go with the VT, the 350 is going to come in and land, and so we're going to have a quick look on the big screens of the Rocketry Challenge. Do we know who won, Neil? We're going to find out in the film. Have we got audio? Oh, okay. I am told by about five different people, sit back, watch it, and there is the audio, and we'll find out the answers. So I'll just shut up now, and we'll have a quick look. Well, if you're watching the big screens and listening to that, and I wasn't, because I thought it was going to go longer, I thought the results would be, but I'm told the results will come out later this afternoon. We were just discussing the eggshells of what you fed the chickens on, of how heavy the shells can be, and whether they're hard-boiled or then raw and all that sort of things. Ian feeds his chickens with graphene, so the shells are very tough. Well, they've been incredibly tough. Now, what's been happening on the airfield while we've been running that VT? Well, the Electra has taxied in now, is taxiing out again, because he had to make way for the 350, who is taxiing in. An update from air traffic. The Electra is holding off because we have a touring item. Well, the next aircraft is a touring item, so we're having a little bit of a change round of the programme. The lecture is going to hold because we're going to bring forward in a way where we don't want to delay him. Not due on yet for, let me have a look, for another 5 minutes or so, but if air traffic are in contact with him, we might bring him forward. This will be the arrival and display of the F-35, operating from Fairfoot. We're just waiting for comms direct with the aircraft. First visual contact we will have of the F-35. It will be running in the distance over by Blackbush, which is what, about 3.8 miles north of here. It'll be running left to right before it turns in to come closer to us from right to left. So that'll be our first visual contact. We're watching on the horizon. We're waiting for RT comms direct to the aircraft. And I'm told he's about 2 minutes away. And the specialist commentator asked for a minute and a half. And he's now changing his mind. I might give him a minute and 41 seconds, because it's my great pleasure to welcome to the commentary position Lieutenant Colonel Richard Rusnock. Welcome. It's all yours.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The Royal Air Force, Royal Navy, and United States Marine Corps take great pleasure in presenting the F-35B Lightning II to you today, the world's only short takeoff, vertical landing, supersonic stealth strike fighter. You're about to view the future of British combat air power. Today, Squadron Leader Hugh Nichols from Warwick, currently based at Marine Corps Air Station Beaufort, South Carolina, with Marine Fighter Attack Training Squadron 501, will be flying at the cutting edge of technology in the F-35B. Already an experienced fighter pilot, Squadron Leader Nichols has been flying the F-35B since 2013. After flying the Block 50 F-16 CM at Shaw Air Force Base, South Carolina. The F-35B is the world's largest defense equipment program that will produce over 3,000 strike fighter aircraft in three variants for a number of countries and partners. The program supports thousands of British industry jobs. The aircraft is made by Lockheed Martin, with Northrop Grumman and BAE Systems as prime subcontractors. Unique to the F-35B variant is the Rolls-Royce lift fan. This allows the 33,000-pound aircraft to conduct short takeoff and vertical landing, or STOVL, operations. This means that the supersonic fighter can get airborne in as little as 300 feet and land vertically by hovering in midair. The Lightning II is referred to as a fifth-generation air platform, the most advanced in the world, due to its combination of integrated sensors, weapons technology, and its low observability or stealth properties. Stealth technology allows the aircraft to fly in enemy airspace without being detected by radars that older aircraft cannot evade. The combination of stealth features, the APG-81 active electronically scanned array radar, the electronic warfare suite, advanced optics, and the ability to carry weapons internally means that the Lightning II can engage targets at long ranges while avoiding detection. Ladies and gentlemen, the aircraft is currently maneuvering north of the airfield, setting up for its initial pass. The Lightning II is capable of speeds of up to Mach 1.6 and can fly up to 50,000 feet. This highly advanced fly-by-wire control system makes it extremely agile and reduces pilot workload throughout the flight envelope. Ladies and gentlemen, if you look to your right, you will see the pilot coming in for the first of two high-speed passes. Ladies and gentlemen, the F-35B Lightning II. The Royal Navy and Air Force currently have over 50 servicemen and women working with Marine Fighter Attack Training Squadron 501 in Beaufort, South Carolina. These personnel will ultimately form the backbone of 617 Squadron as the whole UK contingent swells to over 200 personnel over the next 2 years of operations. The pilot is currently maneuvering for the second high-speed pass from left to right. As the pilot continues to maneuver, he will bring the aircraft in to demonstrate some of the agility of the F-35B. The aircraft will come back and perform a min radius turn near crowd center. Proud to show you what the F-35B can do. It will fly from land and sea, from RAF Marham in Norfolk, and from the deck of Britain's biggest warships, the Queen Elizabeth class carriers that are now being built in Scotland, and are the only aircraft carriers in the world designed specifically for the F-35B Lightning II. While the pilot repositions, get those cameras ready. As the aircraft returns to crowd center, the pilot will complete a slow speed pass that shows the profile of the aircraft to give you the best camera angle possible. is now maneuvering to configure the aircraft for Stovall flight. Approaching crowd center, he will command the aircraft to change to Stovall mode by pressing a single button in the cockpit. You will see several doors opening. The large door on the top of the aircraft, just behind the canopy, is the upper lift fan door, exposing the powerful lift fan that allows the aircraft to hover. You also see doors at the rear of the aircraft, which open to allow the main engine exhaust nozzle, which is manufactured by Rolls-Royce in Bristol, to rotate downward. Squadron Leader Nichols will now bring the aircraft to a hover at crowd center. The entire weight of the aircraft will be supported by the thrust from the lift fan, main engine, and roll control nozzles, collectively generating up to 40,000 pounds of thrust. This ability to hover is unique to the F-35B variant and is what allows it to be based on board aircraft carriers and in austere environments. Let's listen to the power of the engine as the aircraft decelerates into a hover near crowd center. The aircraft is now accelerating away from the hover to return to its deployed base at RAF Fairford. As the aircraft accelerates away, you will notice that the Stovall doors were closing and the landing gear was raised as the aircraft returns to conventional flight before climbing and departing to the west. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes a demonstration of the F-35B Lightning II. The Royal Air Force, Royal Navy, and United States Marine Corps hope you've enjoyed this display in the future of British combat air power.
Richard, indeed we did. Thank you very much indeed. A terrific aircraft, and it's fantastic to have you here at Farnborough. Warwick is pronounced Warwick.
No one's going to take the mickey out of you at all. Flying Control Committee rang through straight away. Your mates here are really good. It's going to cost you so much. After that, we're going to see you again, or we're never going to come here again.
Thank you, sir, for having the opportunity to come up here. And for everybody in the hospitality we received during our 2.5 weeks here in the UK, it's been fantastic. And we're happy to bring this aircraft and show it off. It'll be an RF Marm here in 2018, so it'll be a regular player in air shows.
Fantastic, fantastic. Well, please do thank the team for the huge effort it is to come over here, both for the Fairford show, the Royal International Air Tattoo, and here at Farnborough. So thank you very much indeed.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So back to the program, sponsored by Essentia, the Electra, where is he? Yes, taxi, yeah, onto the runway. We're not expecting the pits, the wingwalkers, builder planes, Starduster, Apache, Spitfire, Typhoon, the Global Stars, the Great Warbird display team, the Dornier 328, the 727 and the Blades, and the P8 Poseidon, still to come in the display. I'm going to have a quick look at our weather radar tracker. I think we're still going to be all right, but it does look a bit darker from the north. We'll have a quick look. Indeed, Swindon, however, it's raining in Swindon. If you go back towards the runway on the takeoff, this beautiful Electra. Listen to these engine noises. Wonderful. As we move towards the public days, more and more of these aircraft were coming into the display, certainly much more tomorrow. I just seem to remember Electra. Now, that's been in a very famous film. I wonder how many people will remember. I'll tell you at the end if I remember to tell you. I know Ian down in the director of One Box Television. I could hear him think just then. And he's stumped as well. The Reds coming across from the other side. They'll be parking just to the left of the commentary position. You see the Blues, the engineers are there. Indeed, the film to which I'm referring, the last line had to be re-recorded because it had two characters walking away in the distance, and they thought they can't do that, and therefore one came back just to lay down the last bit of the audio on it. There's a bit of information about that. Also had something to do with a bar somewhere. So, the Electra now back. This has come all the way across for the Flying Legends Air Show at Duxford for this year, flown all the way from the United States of America. The Electra Junior, often known as the 12, is the first aircraft entirely designed by aviation genius Kelly Johnson, way back, 1935. Of course, Kelly Johnson also designed the P-38 Lightning and then the Constellation. All very different aircraft. The construction number of this aircraft is 1252, if you want that sort of thing. Crew of two, six passengers. It was first delivered in December 1938. After the Second World War, this aircraft was flown by a series of fairly unexciting corporations until it was abandoned in 1976. Donated to a glider museum in Texas, and the owner tracked this aircraft down and purchased it in 89. A long road to restore her to her original spec. Full set of interior hardware, everything from the door handles, ashtrays to dining table, all in a very small town in Texas. The cowlings and original seats came from an abandoned coal coking plant. Now back in her original spec, owned by Patrick Donovan, based in Washington State. Quite a lot of British wartime history with the Electra -12. Many were bought for and conscripted to the Royal Air Force. Sidney Cotton flew a Lockheed 12 around Germany, taking spy photos in that aircraft. Pratt & Whitney Wasp Jr. radial piston engines, about two of those, obviously, one on each side. A lot of the noise of the flypast comes from the propeller tips. Now, certainly on takeoff, just going slightly supersonic at the tips. Similar to like a Harvard that has got that rasp as it goes. It's rather nice just to listen to this classic vintage aircraft, the clattering sound of those Pratt & Whitney Wasp Jr. radial engines and the propeller configuration. Ian, the director, has just asked if I told everybody else the name of the film. Now, I can't remember whether I did. I've told Ian because he got it right. It, of course, is that classic, wonderful film. I'm not going to tell you. Yes, I will. Casablanca. Film Casablanca. Of all the bars in all the places. Often misquoted. Here it comes from right and left. first flight of this magnificent aircraft, not this particular one, but the type, 80 years ago, just over 80 years ago, 27th of June 1936. Around about 130 in total that were built. Extended. Can't be many of these left around the world now, certainly in flying condition. I think it's 10 or 12, something in that sort of region. And to have flown this all the way across from the United States and to participate in the Flying Legend shows and various other shows is really rather lovely. Smoke on the north side of the airfield is from the 1, 2, 3, 4 Stearmans of the Wing Walkers. The smoke doesn't go across the runway, but it low vis proceeds. Starduster just getting airborne from the right. No, it's not, it's a Pitts. I've jumped about 20 minutes, a Pitts. That's an interesting way. Straight into knife edge just after airborne. That's really rather a nice way to get airborne and depart. Long knife edge straight away once airborne. That's a Pitts. The whole batting order changed around slightly around the F-35. So I think we might be going in straight into the display from the pit special. I believe we're going to be trying a little bit of a sequence of downloading film directly from the cockpit. Not today, we're going to do it as a practice. We're going to do it live for tomorrow. Bet that startled the camera crew. Pitt's been around, Curtis Pitts designed it before the war. It's got the same amount of lift upside down as the right way up, used in advanced aerobatics and aerobatic competitions worldwide. Certainly 1976, or the British team in Kiev using the Pitt Special, the great Neil Williams used the Pitt Special. It's a very tough, good rate of roll. Still very much a competent aerobatic aircraft. And we actually have this aircraft fitted to fly with or without pyros. I don't know whether we're getting any pyros. Hanging there on the propeller. No pyros today, I'm told. Hanging there on the propeller, driving out onto the A-axis. Aerobatic-wise, we talk about the A-axis going left to right. The B-axis is away and towards you. Pulling up for a half loop and then into a 2.5 degree negative tumble at the top. Let them look. Oh, pushing out and tumbling everywhere. Oh, my Lord. Pulling into the vertical, four-point hesitation roll on the way up. So check the vertical, roll, check, roll, check, roll, check. You can see the ailerons, bring it round, stop. Still got a bit of energy there. Going up into a hammerhead, back down towards us, double hammerhead, boom, whang. You can see more of this in aerobatics later on, I'm sure. Pull back into the vertical for a couple of negative snap rolls, flick rolls. So on the way up, and boom, negative G. Rolling down on the way down, back onto the 45 degree to the crowd line. And this time, I believe, positioning for a loop with a triple negative snap roll, shoulder roll at the top. Crikey, if two's not enough. So pulling up, 5-6 G on the pull initially, check, and then negative G, once, twice. Twice round, I thought we were going for three. It was three, I missed the first one. Rolling inverted to another push, half outside loop. Negative G. Rolling through cockpit, filling with smoke. It's a very tough aircraft, the Pitts Special. Well, the Pitts, various different types of engine you can have under the bonnet. I like the colour scheme as well. You normally have a sunburst type colour scheme on the upper wing. That helps in aerobatic competitions when you're judging which way around the aircraft is actually facing for you. So you have the sunburst type on the top. In to the 45 degree climb, couple of rolls on the way up, climbing, climbing, and then reversing quickly into double flick, end over end. Sideways, negative G. Around, I think, to the first day that we've had the Pitts, I think, to pick up the nose slightly, then roll inverted. It's said here, but he's not going to do that. Great fly down the runway. Got plenty of speed. Pulling up. Continuing over the top of a loop. Check, roll once, twice. Down on the 45 degree, back down towards crowd center for the inverted pass. Pushing outside a loop, back round onto all the way down. Knife edge, again, a bit like we saw on the departure, but there's a bit of climb to a flick roll, one way, hold it, check, into knife edge. Large ailerons, decent size of rudder to give a decent boot in to keep that knife edge going. Series of rolls, rolls, around a rolling circle, 270 degrees of a rolling circle. Rolling out ways, you can do a rolling circle in as well. That's when judging gets complicated, when people say, did he roll in or roll out? And you think, I don't know, I can't remember. Into a flat turn, the boot full of rudder skidding around the sky. All the way around. Coming back again for an extra little maneuver into the vertical, roll, check, push, tumble, ooh, that's lunch. Lost from sight with the commentary position. Hanging there on the prop, taking advantage of watching the big screen, I've got a monitor in here.
great registration. Another series of tumbles, reversal direction. Not the sort of aerobatics for the faint-hearted, that's for definite. Completely different aerobatics to that of jet aerobatics. Do so much more with the gyroscopic effect of the propeller, the wind blasts across the tail. Rate of roll can be around about 270 degrees per second on the pit special. Or the pits. High pitch pass, do push, then into gain, tumbles, tumbles, tumbles. Edge pass down the runway, nice and slow, very slow. That's cool. That's really cool. You don't often see that on the display circuit. Wow, I like that. I like that a lot. This has been a very skillful aerobatic sequence, I must say. Very skillful indeed. A very, very polished aerobatic sequence. TV crew saying top mark to that show, certainly. And behind them, the
Breitling wing walkers are moving out. Airborne now, the four aircraft, the Breitling wing walkers, with the girls strapped to the top of the wing. Now, when they come back, if they're waving at you, we can wave back at them. And once again, you've got the rasp of the propeller tips, as I talked about, a bit like the Harvard, again on the Boeing Stearman, of which these aircraft are. Very tough aircraft, the Stearman. I find that even I can do aerobatics that's recognisable well, just in a Stearman. It's difficult to actually break a Stearman unless you hit the ground. It's very, very tough. What my instructor told me. Well, that's good close formation, I must say. They've actually done batten to batten, passing one batten from one girl to another girl, with one aircraft flying inverted. I don't think they're going to do that today. So the girls are inverted, the aircraft are the right way up. These are 1940 Boeing Stearmans. Throughout this display, they'll be flying at varying speeds between 80 and 150 miles. The wind against the girls can be compared to that putting your hand out the window on the motorway. That's only at 70 miles an hour. You know what? Well, don't try on the way home. I don't want to encourage that sort of thing on the motorway. Mind you, it's the M25. You're never going to get up to 70 miles an hour, so you're perfectly safe there. Not to mention the occasional raindrops and the flies on the teeth when they land. Using a swivel mount on the top of the aircraft in which they're strapped. Very pretty tight formation. Throughout the display, the G-forces, plus 4 to minus 2G. Indeed, at the end of the display, you'll see the girls climbing down into the cockpit because they've had enough. Sponsored by Swiss watch specialist Breitling, who are actually in charge of the timing in the commentary box. I'm using Breitling at the moment, Breitling time. Team have been all over the world. They've been in China, India, United Arab Emirates, Australia, to name but a few. Jointly insured by Liberty Specialist Markets. By quite good insulated leather. Well, they used to have leather suits until they discovered what happens to leather when it rained. Now far better suits. The team were in the United Arab Emirates this winter, India, February last year, Japan, May last year as well. These aircraft have been modded somewhat, extra ailerons and a bigger engine, fitted with a massive 450 horsepower Pratt & Whitney radial engine. That propeller, incidentally, its diameter is 10 feet in diameter. Say the brass from the propeller tips just going supersonic occasionally. Noisy here. What do you think it's like for the girls? That's a very good formation. That really is very good. I mean, wing walking itself, it's been around for a long time. Dates back to when young flying aces returned from the First World War. got addicted to the thrill of flying and didn't have a job to go to, so they had to make up their way of getting money. They went around all over the United States in various places in these flying circuses, giving rides in outlandish places and also wing walking, thinking of other flying circus tricks to do. And that's where, to enter the crowds, failing sure they returned, the crowd travelers, the pilots began to persuade their girlfriends and engineers to walk out along their biplanes. How would you say, sweetheart, darling, would you like to just walk out on the wing, don't fall off? If you do, don't damage the aeroplane. I mean, crikey. That's neat. The Breitling wing walkers recreate the fearless glamour of those pioneering years, utilizing the latest technology, bringing all the vitality and pizzazz from the 1920s, is what it says in the script. Actually, Breitling been around with aviation for a long time, strong aviation heritage, flying instruments professionals. Wing walking team is honored to represent the Breitling brand. Precision timing is as critical aspect of display flying as anything else. The wing walkers. Florence Robinson-Smith, mere 22, a mere stripling. Mary Kilby, 34. Nikita Salmon, 24. All from all over the country. And they just really enjoy doing it. You know, one of them is studying at Cardiff University. She's studying physiological and sociology. That's Nikita. Pilots, David Barrow, Martin Carrington. I've known Martin for years and years and years. Been doing this for 15 years. He's the director of flying, 15th season with the team. Steve Hicks. Currently, Steve Hicks actually is training captain on the 380 for British Airways. I knew Steve when we flew 747s together with British Airways. Nick Barnard. So one of the pilots. Open cockpit means the pilot is at the mercy, or so the wing walkers, of the elements. Actually, they have good communications, sometimes using hand signals, sometimes a bit more aggressive than normal, and comms back and forth to the girls. And obviously for long transits, that's why they've devised a system the girls can clamber down into the cockpit rather than stay on the top for a long transit across Europe. So the bunts either way, so positive G, and in a moment a bit of a push to go down again. It is certainly not everybody's cup of tea doing wing walking and still moving your arms, legs around. It toughens you up. Certainly these girls are fit. Visibility on the airfield dropping somewhat with the amount of smoke being produced. Opposing left and right. Give them a wave when they go past, certainly, and I think they probably all come through together. But they can see us. They're doing the hard work. another opposing cross. Again, this is the first day that we've seen them here at Farnborough. Display centre is just by and opposite the air traffic control. It's an odd, curious public display line here at Farnborough. Centre is down this end, well, the middle of the airfield by the air traffic control. Although I know most of you are standing up at the east end. So the girls unstrapping from the harness, clambering down into the cockpit in preparation for landing. I've lost two completely from the smoke. Starting to clamber down. Is that the sort of pose from Titanic on the bow? What was the piece? Do you want me to sing it? No, I didn't think you did. No. You know it, and you know why I'm not going to say it. That's very tight formation. This formation flying has been very, very competent. A lot of work and practice running up to the spaces to get up to standard. All these sort of things look relatively easy, but it's hard graft. A lot of practice, a lot of trust in your mate as well. You've always got to have an exit strategy at any stage. You know, if one gets a bird strike or an oil leak or anything like that, there's exit strategies all the time in displaying flying. So it's not just a matter of just staying in formation. A lot of work going on. Girls now in the cockpit. Do you suppose they have a nice hot cup of coffee when they get in? Certain magic and mystery behind the scenes of how they unclip and get down. At one point, they're probably not connected to very much. We're not telling the secrets. Fortunately, I'm too heavy and too big to do wing walking. So they've never invited me, so that's my cop out. That and I'll be just too frightened. It's the same, we've always missed the round on the airfield. The director for One Box Television, we could reenact the final scene of Casablanca. It's the beginning of a beautiful friendship. Arnold words re-recorded. Well, they weren't recorded the first time. They'd come back and do it again. So the Steelman Turning final. Let's have a look at the programme. What do we got next? Give me that. Thank you. Starduster to get airborne. And once the Starduster is airborne, we're going to have the builder plane and the specialist commentators. We've got a whole collection of commentators that have joined us in the commentary box. We'll explain all about that. The Starduster will come back into display. Then we'll have the Spitfire to get airborne, the Apache to get airborne and display. Timings are a little bit different to what I've got in front of me, so I'm not going to give any more timings. The Apache to display, then the Spitfire to display, and I will not commentate over the noise of the Spitfire. It speaks for itself, it is music itself, it is the sound of freedom, and I will be silent throughout the Spitfire display so you can record it and just enjoy it on itself. After all, we're still not trying to sell them. After the Spitfire, we change the noise above Farnborough completely because we go to Typhoon. After Typhoon, Global Stars, then the Great Warbird display team, then the Dornier 328, then the 727 from Boeing flying in formation with the blades, and then the P-8A Poseidon. So a lot still to happen. We're going to do a shuffle around here shortly. Just check on whether the Starduster is going to display straight away or whether we're going to have build a plane. Build a plane, I'm told. Starduster airborne to hold. We're watching out, and that could be the builder plane moving out onto the runway. And it's my great pleasure to hand over to Ian Bathasaur. Is that the correct pronunciation? Well, I'm sure you can probably do it yourself. Past president of the Royal Aeronautical Society, based, of course, at Hamilton Place in London. And it's a great pleasure to have you in the commentary box to explain everything about this next item.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. This aircraft, which is taxiing out for takeoff now, is a RANS S6 ES Coyote Microlite, flown by Graham Wiley, a member of the local Royal Aeronautical Society branch in the Midlands. This has been made from a kit by students at Erkelwood Technology College and Phoenix School near Telford. And I'm delighted to be joined for this commentary by two of the students who have built another of the aircraft, Iviana and Jamie. Now, although this is probably the smallest and cheapest aircraft in the flying display, it is packed with inspiration. Whilst Tracy Curtis Taylor's Boeing Stearman that you can see on the flight line is the Spirit of Artemis, I think we should call this aircraft the Spirit of Inspiration, because this has been one of the most inspirational programs that I know of. This is one of the six aircraft in the Boeing Royal Aeronautical Society's Schools Build-A-Plane Challenge program. This was originally inspired by air cadets in Manchester who built their own microlight aircraft. And the air cadets celebrate their 75th anniversary this year. And both Eviana and I have been inspired about aviation during our time as the air cadets. And I was very pleased to learn today that Boeing, the Air League and the Royal Air Force have launched a program in Northern Ireland with the air cadets to build another aircraft for the 100th anniversary of the Royal Air Force in 2016. The Build-A-Plane Challenge program itself has inspired 12 other schools throughout the United Kingdom to make their own aircraft. The aim of this Build-A-Plane Challenge program is to motivate young people about science, technology, engineering and maths, STEM. And so far, probably around 12, 13,000 young people have seen these aircraft made by students at various displays and events throughout the UK. The program also develops key skills in teamworking and project management that is so vital to future careers. Funded primarily by the Boeing Aircraft Company, who today celebrate 100 years in aviation, the Challenge program is a partnership of a number of organizations and groups. The Royal Aeronautical Society, which celebrates its 150th anniversary this year, run the program, with the local Cosford, Birmingham and Wolverhampton branch overseeing this aircraft in the flying display today. The Ministry of Defence second graduates to help manage the program, and the Light Aviation Association, who will also celebrate an anniversary this year, their 70th, advise the program, carry out regular inspections and issue the permit to fly. The main players, though, are the students of the schools involved. They construct parts and assemble the aircraft, supervised by their teachers, whom I believe have provided inspirational leadership to stimulate STEM in their schools and colleges. Three other aircraft are being built in Bristol, Coventry and Wolverhampton, and you can see the aircraft under construction by students in the Northeast Wolverhampton Academy in the static display, and talk to students from there from Marlin and Yateley schools who have already built and sold their aircraft. Another key partner in the partnership are the volunteers who guide students in the special skills necessary for building an aircraft. STEM is a vital part of every single manufactured item, not just this aircraft, but from the clothes you're wearing to all the magnificent aircraft in the flying display today. Do go and see the STEM exhibitions in the Innovation Zone, where you'll be seeing fascinating products and other exciting STEM activities that will challenge you. Now, Eviana, you're project manager on the program at the Northeast Wolverhampton Academy. What have you enjoyed about this program?
I've enjoyed everything about it.
What sort of things have you learned?
Everything really, different types of tools, what works on the plane, how it flies.
Okay, what else has been exciting on the program for you? You were telling me earlier about riveting, that you enjoyed doing that.
Yeah, that's really fun, that is.
And what about the best bit? What was the best bit?
Everything.
Okay.
I've enjoyed everything about it.
Are you looking forward to flying in the aircraft that you built?
Definitely.
Right. Jamie, what about you? What have you enjoyed in the programme?
As Ivana said, I've enjoyed everything because it's just a fun thing to do when you've got nothing else to do.
And what have you learned, do you think?
I've learned different types of materials and what was used to build a plane and how to build a plane.
And as well as actually building the aircraft, have you been in any other organisational activities?
Not yet.
Okay, but you're looking forward to perhaps doing a bit of project management in it?
Yeah.
Okay. Right, thanks very much. Just whilst Graham Wiley is landing, you might like to know a little bit about the aircraft. This one, Golf Golf Whiskey Foxtrot Tango, made by RANS, an American company that started out building bicycles, and still does in fact. Does that sound familiar? Right, the Wright brothers, who back in 1903 threw the first powered controlled aircraft, were also bicycle manufacturers. This aircraft has an empty weight of 2,062 kilograms, got a Jabiru 2200 engine, and in terms of the performance, you might have missed the impressive takeoff roll of 49 meters, but you've probably just seen the amazing 61-meter landing. With a ceiling of 70,000 feet, you'd need oxygen, but we haven't done that. We haven't had time to do that in this display. Thank you very much indeed for sharing with us one of the most inspirational programs that that there is around.
And if you look above, we've got the return of the next item for aerobatics. This is the Starduster from Trestel, the SA300 Trestel Starduster, doing a lovely, beautiful set of aerobatics. Totally different to the pits. It looks similar, but it's totally different. It's a pleasant and fun aircraft to fly. More than 100 Stardusters are still flying throughout the world because they were designed way back in 1960 by Louis Stolp. Today being flown by Jean-Marc Dost, who's the vice president of Trestel, hence the colours of the group. Trestel Group, global player in calibration services, which provides verification, repair and calibration of measurement instruments in things like the physical, the electrical, the mechanical domains. Has operations in 21 countries in Europe, North Africa, Asia, South America and the United States of America. Amateur-built aircraft, use an original manufacturing process. The main fuselage is made of aluminium tubes, coated with canvas, and the wings are made of wood. Docile and easy to fly. 375 horsepower under the bonnet. Stress to plus 6, minus 6 G. Jean-Marc has taken this aircraft to shows around the world. Represented the company recently in Paris, in Berlin and Marrakesh. Today representing the United Kingdom branch of the Trestel Group, which has over 10 calibration laboratories in this country. I think they've got a stand in Hall 4. I walked past it, Hall 4, so trying to remember the door I went in and came out. It'd be round about stand H80, something like that, if you wanted to go and see them. Many Stardusters have reached over 2,500 flying hours. One of them's even gone over 5,000 hours, so rugged and a competent aircraft to own. A nice, pretty, gentle sequence of aerobatics. What are you looking up, Mark? You're not, you don't believe I've given you the right place, but I'm right. No, I even gave the stand number, I reckon. Memory, if we walked in that door this morning, H80 I'm going for. Running back in on the 45 degree, accelerating away, smoke on. Nice slow roll into knife edge for a long pass down the runway. Breaking to position to downwind. as the Starduster touches down. Again, I'm joined in the commentary position by another expert witness. This is from the Army Air Corps down at Wallop.
Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and welcome to the 2016 attack helicopter display. I appreciate being called an expert, and it's very flattering indeed. My name is Captain David Price, and I'll be your commentator today.
X is an unknown quantity and asperges drip under pressure. I'm glad that you like that compliment. Welcome to the commentary position.
Well, thank you. And if you look to the right, you can see the Apache now taxiing out towards the runway. And today's pilots are Adam Nash, Captain Blake Lee, and both of which are currently serving frontline pilots from 3 Regiment Army Air Corps, based out of Wadisham, sorry, not Middle Wallop, Wadisham Station in Suffolk. They both have operational experience from Afghanistan. Warrant Officer Nash from his tours with 663 Squadron, and Captain Blake Lee from his attachment to the United States Army. And Warrant Officer Nash has asked me to remind everyone, today is his 20th year in the service. The display aircraft you can see on the side of the rocket pods is callsign Gunship, and it's from our combat ready pool. These are ready to deploy at short notice. The aircraft is at its operational weight, which has been provided by the dummy Hellfire missiles you can see on the pylons. During the routine, I'll take the opportunity to talk to you about the full range of weapons available to the crew whilst they fly the aircraft right to the limits of pitch, roll, and G. As you've just seen, Apache have just used a running takeoff, which is a standard maneuver for all frontline crews, allowing us to get the aircraft up to a safe speed before departing the ground. And if you just follow it to the left of the crowd, you'll see them repositioning to start the sequence. And as you can see now, the crew are now pitching to 45 degrees nose up, 90 degrees angular bank, to start the show with a 180 degree wing over. As they run back into crowd center, they'll shortly be pitching to 60 degrees nose up, 90 degrees angular bank for the 270 degree wing over. As the aircraft exits out the B axis, they're now repositioning for the wheel off axis gun. This maneuver will be used operationally to allow the optics and 30mm cannon to be constantly positioned at a target in the center of the wheel and will allow for rapid engagements if required. The cannon has a cyclic rate of 625 rounds per minute, and the aircraft can carry up to 1,200 high explosive rounds on board. As the Apache once again repositions out at crowd left, we can appreciate the effort it put in during the Herrick conflict, where the British Apache flew over 51,000 hours, and that's more than any other British aircraft. As they reapproach crowd center, they're using their powerful turbomeca engines to accelerate to 140 knots in a profile that could be used to put down strafing fire with a cannon. They're now repositioning into a modified rapid climb to adopt a diving fire profile. This could be used operationally to deliver the CRV-7 rockets onto a target. The dive also allows the crew to manipulate the effect the rocket has at the target. As they exit the diving fire profile, they're now accelerating to position for a bunt. As you can see, this pitches the aircraft to 90 degrees nose up and then 90 degrees nose down. Each of the engines can produce 2,300 shaft horsepower, which means the Apache has over 4 Formula One race cars on board. The wing over maneuver you see they're using at crowd left is not only reserved for displays, but is one of the best ways to turn the aircraft around and is used routinely by frontline crews. As gunship returns to crowd center, the crew would shortly perform a rapid climb. This will show the excellent rate of climb that the powerful engines enable the aircraft to have. It will be used to maneuver the Apache rapidly through what is known operationally as the threat band. This is where aircraft are most susceptible to small arms fire. The Apache's optics are able to look to up to 60 degrees down from the horizontal, giving the crew good field of view onto a prospective target area. Just as they rapidly have to climb through the threat band, they have to be able to descend through it rapidly as well. The Apache is once again converting its speed into height, pitching to an awesome 90 degrees nose up to perform a pedal turn. When the aircraft reaches zero airspeed, the crew can use the Apache's powerful tail rotor to rotate the aircraft 180 degrees about the center. Now, as they approach crowd center, they can perform a new maneuver for the 2016 season. This is known as the corkscrew. Sees the aircraft pitching to 90 degrees nose up, then rapidly repositioning to the hover, where the crew perform a 180 degree spot turn before exiting 90 degrees nose down. This shows the immense agility of this 10-ton aircraft, and along with the pedal turn is one of the most difficult maneuvers to fly. As they exit the corkscrew, they're conducting a 360 quick stop to arrive at the hover. The Apache has four weapon stations on its pylons. The aircraft can be fitted with either CRV-7 rocket pods, Hellfire missile launchers, or external fuel tanks. And as you can see today, gunship have opted for a mixture of rocket pods and missile launchers. Each rocket pod can house up to 19 rockets, and the missile launchers can each hold up to 4 missiles. Both the rockets and missiles can be fired out to ranges of up to 8 kilometers, whilst the powerful M230 cannon can fire out to a staggering 4,200 meters. As you watch the aircraft move right to left, you can see the Apache's amazing hover performance. The Apache is one of the few helicopters that is fitted with a stabilator. This is the horizontal wing mounted just below the tail rotor. This helps keep the Apache as stable as possible to deliver weapons onto a target. Now, if you look to the top, you can see the helicopter's fire control radar dome mounted above the main rotor blades. This scans out to 8 kilometers, could detect 1,024 targets, prioritize them, and then provide 16 simultaneous firing solutions through the aircraft's weapon processors. The radar is not only used to find targets and provide weapon guidance, however, it can be used in a setting called terrain profile mode, which maps out the ground in front of the aircraft to help navigate in very poor weather. As the crew now position out to crowd left, the pilots are using their helmet-mounted monocles to aid them to fly the maneuver, with all the important aircraft information being displayed in the eye. This allows them to keep their eye out of the cockpit at all times. You see the crew now returning back to crowd center. This time they're going to perform a 360 degree wing over. This once again demonstrates how agile the Apache is and why it's such an asset to the British Armed Forces. As they exit the 360, they're now performing a 270 quick stop to arrive at the Hover crowd centre. And as you do so, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for the 2016 Attack Helicopter Display Team. The aircraft will shortly perform a bow to depart. And as it does, I'd like to thank Farnborough Airshow for inviting us, and of course you, the general public, for your continued support to the British Armed Forces. There are a variety of hugely exciting job opportunities for you in the Army Air Corps, far more than I could do justice in just a 10-minute display. But if you do have any questions, please find a member of the display team or search Army Jobs online. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And how come you got into Army flying then? Did you join the Army Air Corps direct or to a different regiment first?
To be honest, I was brought up in Hong Kong, and I remember thinking about joining the Cathay Pacific cadet program. And basically, I remember someone saying something about the Army. My dad, coincidentally, was in the Army Royal Engineers, and hence why I was living out there. And then at university, I was walking down the street after a few beers in the bar, as you do. I remember just someone mentioning something about Apache, and I thought, oh, why not give it a go? And luckily for me, I managed to jump through all the various hurdles, I suppose, and find myself here today.
Fantastic. Well, thank the team. You're flying tomorrow and the following day?
Absolutely. And tomorrow and on Sunday, we have the pyrotechnics to accompany the display, which add a new dimension, shall we call it, along with a tactical element. Same routine, but put into context, shall we say.
I don't want to be totally downwind of that when it happens. If you just displace it slightly so it goes over everybody else bar me. We were struck by lightning on Wednesday. I've had enough of pyrotechnics close to this commentary box.
I'll make sure I let the team know. I mean, it's the same team that did the James Bond movie, the recent one, Spectre. So they're a pretty professional outfit. So I'd like to think they'll be able to keep it where we need it.
Exactly. Well, thank you very much. We'll see you tomorrow. Please do thank the team. I mean, it's a fantastic looking aircraft in itself, isn't it? Is this one built down in Falcon Field out in Mesa?
I know these are all built under license, actually, from what was Augusta Westland. Now it's become Leonardo, I believe. And they're built down in Somerset, near the Oval.
Perfect. Great. Well, we'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Of a propeller and lead the Spitfire, it is not a good idea. The blade's just getting airborne. They're getting airborne. They will be joining up. No, not the blades. This will be the Global Stars. Blades to get airborne a little bit later on. So looking down, Spitfire is scrubbed. Typhoon is next. Global Stars, Great Warbird display team, blades to get airborne. Join up with the 727, which also going to take off, then the Dornier through to 328, return of the blades and the 727s and the PA. So a little bit of a chop and change around, blades gone later. So these are the Global Stars airborne. They will be holding to the south, and the next aircraft to take the runway will be Noise. I don't know what altitude we're getting, but I'm just going to quick look at the weather radar to see what's going on. There's a bit of low cloud, a bit of rain out to the northwest of here. Just checking it to see if it's going to come in here.
that's quite old. If you could hit the refresh key on that, Mark, that would be quite good. I don't think it's still 11 o'clock in the morning. Don't whinge. Get on with it. That little round arrow at the top thing says refresh. Stop whinging. And at the same time, as you're checking the weather radar, have you rung air traffic to find out what height we've got for the show? We normally have 3,200 feet above us, which is ours, and then we borrow up to 8,000 feet above us. Taking off in full reheat, dramatic against the dark sky. Typhoon has been ordered by eight nations: United Kingdom, Germany, Italy, Spain, Austria, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, the Sultan of Oman, and the state of Kuwait. High G, I think we're obviously going to be in the low show manoeuvre. Flown today by the BAE Systems experimental test pilot Nat Makepeace. It with kit on, the Brimstones, outboard wing pilots. It's got two 1,000 litre supersonic fuel tanks. Well, the tanks themselves are not supersonic unless they're connected to the aeroplane. And the aeroplane doing supersonic at the time. Yeah, I know. A full digital colour helmet mounted display, which builds on decades of combat proven experience by BAE Systems. That provides the jet pilot with an exceptional all day and night vision, target tracking technology, all displayed straight away, like having your own head up display attached to you rather than having to look through it. Popping in and out of a bit of low cloud. I think it's very wise that we're not flying this a bit far, because I think there's a bit of rain on the way at the moment. Probably we've got a few minutes until the rain actually gets here. In fact, I'm going to say it's less than that now. This is the full phase 3 enhancement weapons fit. First time that this has flown like this at any major air show. Various different phases have happened, P2E, P3E, this is the 3. Max level speed of Typhoon is Mark 2, that's twice the speed of sound. And at low level, the aircraft is in just 30 seconds. Service ceiling 55,000 feet, no problems. But it disappeared in the murk. Of course, the Royal Air Force has Typhoons on standby 24/7 as part of the defence system of the United Kingdom. And they do get scrambled fairly often when airliners or aircraft approach United Kingdom airspace without being totally identified or a radio failure. Inverted pass. In terms of the G limits, plus 9 and minus 3. inside the cockpit, an advanced hands-on throttle and stick system, wide head-up display. Typhoon has 13 external hardpoints. 5 are located on the fuselage, 4 on each wing. Weapons choices are numerous. They include the AIM-120s, Meteor and Sidewinder missiles for air-to-air ops, along with Brimstone, Taurus, Storm Shadow and Paveway munitions for air-to-surface missions. And if that's not enough, on the starboard side of the aircraft is a 27mm Mauser gun. Worsening weather. Well, the radar tracker has just failed and gone down. I was trying to see what the depth of this rain cloud was going to be, give you an idea of how long it's going to rain for. Winds picked up a bit. Looking at the big screens, I can see Eurofighter Typhoon turning final. Lights picking it up on the approach into land. I'm not certain now whether we're going to get the Global Stars or the Great Warbird display team. We're just trying to sort that out and communicate with them at the moment. It's their decision, of course. There's Typhoon back down. Wonderful display in ever decreasing visibility from Nat Makepeace. Heard that the Global Stars are just going to come back into land. Air traffic in communication with the Great Warbird display team. They are holding up towards Blackbush. This sorts out the Flying Control Committee, who happen to be on the phone at the moment. Hello, chaps. Are you all right over there? Not raining on the south side as much as it is on the north side. Briefing this morning, Amy, who's in charge of Met today, told me, guaranteed to me, promised me that there'd be no rain. Indeed, said the cloud would be quite high and quite flyable. We'll have to have words tomorrow. So the Global Stars on the ground. Looking at our timings, we are fine, we're still okay. So what we're going to do is just roll the gap in the display and wait to see as the weather comes and goes where we're going to be. So if you're inside, what I'm going to do is just give you a rest from my voice. Don't all cheer at the same time. And As soon as we do have an update, I will come back on the air. I won't keep prattling at you. Let you have a bit of a rest from that, and I'll let you know what's going on as we know. But still planned, the Great War Display Team, the Dornier 328, the 727 with the blades in formation, the P8 Poseidon. Actually, the program for this aircraft, the A400M Atlas, originated with the European Future Large Aircraft requirement way back in 1992. Supported by the nations of Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, Portugal, Spain and Turkey. Long evaluation phase. Beginning of the construction started the first aircraft in January 05. Maiden flight December 06. That flight test program amassed some 5,665 hours. It's already received its full civil and military certifications. Designed for the carriage of troops and oversized cargoes included armored vehicles and helicopters. The ability to undertake tactical delivery operations from unprepared strips was of significant importance. In other words, it can land on really rough, short, narrow strips. It can then use those huge propellers to reverse down the strip, get rid of its load, take off without having to do any U-turns on the runway, and therefore minimize the time on the ground and therefore greater efficiency of delivering whatever it is you wish to deliver. The engines are the Europrop International, rated at 13,000 shaft horsepower. Now those propellers in reverse pitch, those props can reverse the aircraft up a 2-degree concrete slope at max takeoff weight, reversing. If you look at the big screen, you can see the scaffolding pole just ahead of the flight deck. That's the in-flight refueling probe. Talking about those big propellers, the adjacent propellers on each wing rotate in opposite directions to produce down between the engine's airflow. Now the major benefits of this are reduced wing loading, more symmetrical airflow, greater lift distribution, and improved engine out handling. And indeed, that whole method, that whole concept, adds to 4% of lift. Crew of two, NVG, night vision goggle capability. Head-up display, big head-up display. Also got a third seat for the tactical mission commander, if you so wish, and you've got the loadmaster station down in the cargo area. Quite right. In terms of cargo, the A400M can carry armoured vehicles, things like the M113 or the Warrior, helicopters where you can stick in the back, Super Puma, a couple of Apaches, Tiger gunship, not all at the same time, they'd all fight. Up to 116 fully knitted, fully kitted troops can be transported on sidewall and removable centerline seats. Oh, I suppose YouTube, I'm in for it now. In the medical role, the type can carry 66 stretchers and 25 medical staff. And it can cruise around about 300 knots. It's got a great rate of climb. It's very versatile, very flexible, as you can see. Diving steep to the ground. Side stick flying controls, all by fly-by-wire. Depending on what you're going to do with the aircraft, the A400M is expected to have a minimum service life of 30,000 hours, even taking into account the roughness that you get on low-level operations, short field deployment. Reckon that the export market over the next 25 years will account for something like 400 of this type of airlifter. Most recent order placed by Malaysia, who require 4 aircraft with air-to-air refueling capability. Current production rate, which will be stepped up as required. Production rate for Atlas is around 2.5 aircraft per month. Airdrop operations can be conducted anywhere between 125 knots and 200 knots. Depends on how long you want to stay in the hot zone, I suppose, really, isn't it? 22 of these type of aircraft are operated in the United Kingdom or on order. First one, I think, came a couple of years ago, November 14. Deep approach, let's have a look at the runway lights. Yes, they're out. That means that he is positioning for a landing. It'll be a very short landing using the reverse pitch propellers. We get a little bit of reversing, I think, or maybe a 360-degree turn on the runway. Just depends on the layout of the taxiways for after landing to what he's going to do. The A350 is floating around, joining up with the Red Arrows, of which we're expecting that flypast to be from your left to your right of the 350 with the Red Arrows, but I will confirm that once I get them in sight, but that's the plan, I believe. A400M just touching down. You can hear the reverse pitch props coming in. There they go. And reversing down the runway at quite a good speed, actually. That's quite a good rate. When you're reversing an airliner like this or an aircraft like this, what you don't do when you want to come to a halt is put your feet on the brakes, because you normally smack the tail in the ground. So you actually have to go into forward thrust to come to a halt. And as long as your nose wheel's on the center line of the runway, you can't get too wrong and run off into the wet. And I guess sometimes the load master's leaning out the back and saying, à droite and la gauche, or à gauche, which is one is left and right, or the other way around. So the 350, we can see that is definitely holding out towards the left over Laffin's Plain, almost heading down towards Odium at the moment, which is only about 8 miles away. Incidentally, when we had our horrendous rain on Monday of 21.2 millimeters, Odium had 0.1. Not fair. Doing a 180 degree turn on the runway. The stickers you got down the back end of the fuselage, the yellow checkered stickers, that's all part of flight test programs. They can see where stress points are, it's all for data gathering, and that's all to do with the testing. That's not normally on a current production aircraft. You can see that it's a test machine. So we're tracking the 350 at the moment, down in the Odium area. So tracking the 350s down to the southwest, looks like potentially lining up towards, we're watching him holding currently at 1700 feet, doing 295 knots and heading certainly our direction. And as I say that, it looks like he's just turned away again. There we go. And Mark, you've seen the red somewhere, have you?
I have. They were further south. I think they've turned out towards the west. No, you can see them running in behind the 350.
For I've
those, of those of you that can see the aircraft to the left.
Looking on the big screens, if you're near a big screen, with the camera work that we've got, looking a long way down towards Lafton's plane, we can see the reds just tucking in to the 350. Final checks be done, final calls, speed adjustments. I understand we get one flyby only left to right of the 350 with the reds. 350 will then break off, come into land, then the reds will come back to land here at Farnborough. Two sections of the red arrow is now closing up on the 350. Those eagle-wide ones of you, and Ian, the director of One Box Television, has already spotted it, the fact there are 10 hawks there. Well, they go around in 10, so you've always got a spare, but it also brings the manager or the commentator in to the shows, and it's always useful to have a spare hawk. So I think probably the number 10 won't necessarily be in the formation, but he might be a bit higher taking photographs, or indeed he might tuck in himself. I suspect from this orbit, they must really soon be all on board. My tracker's stopped tracking. Gyrocopter airborne. So while we'll just do a quick flip to hold off the Reds and the 350, this is from Total Calidus, the auto gyro. It's a long time since we've had an auto gyro here. Long, long time since auto gyro displayed at Farnborough. It's very light. Max takeoff weight, around about 500 kilos, tandem two-seat aircraft, designed in Germany in 2009.
corkscrew along the A axis. It's the smoke is intentional, by the way. Flying speeds auto gyro anywhere between 0 and 120 miles an hour. That rotor on the top is not driven at all. It's the wind going up through the rotor blade that's turning it. So you're always in auto rotation. Those who fly helicopters will understand that. The air going up through the blade is forcing it to turn, which is giving you the lift. Flat 360-degree rudder turns. Great safe flight envelope. And it's really just that blast of speed. Auto gyros, in a sense, cannot stall. Sponsored by Air Total and Sydney Charles Insurance. Other sponsors, Pooley's Pilot Supplies, Sky Demon Navigation Software and Vertigo Aircraft Covers. Auto gyro has been seen in the United Kingdom, in France and in Germany. Cheap to run, 12 to 18 litres per hour. And if you're cracking along at about 100 miles an hour, something like that, that's quite good. It's a propeller at the back, the pusher propeller, so it's a proper propeller. Pushes the aircraft forward in flight. That's why you get that rotor just slightly inclined back. That's how you start the takeoff run, certainly. Certainly getting a closer look of this aircraft than you do with some of the other aircraft that have to display a bit further away from us. The sequence you're seeing is not really a set sequence, it's just tailored to suit each event and wherever it is. And there's a sort of a showing the agility of the auto gyro. Peter Davis. Flying for 35 years, gyro planes for 22 years, so he knows what he's doing. He's achieved the first gold Calibri, first gold to be awarded in the world for achievements in microlights. Came fourth himself in the first World Microlight Championships, winning the speed event outright. Set a couple of world distance records. He won the 1994 Around the World Air Race. Borrow dive. This is first time we've seen the auto gyro here. We haven't had it for the rest of the week, so this is new to me as well. They're great fun to fly. I had a happy afternoon flying an auto gyro in Kent, I think it was last year. There must be a description to this maneuver. I'm told it's the combination roll. Well, crikey, that is really chucking it about. Wow. Which James Bond movie had the auto gyro in? Little Nelly.
Little Nelly.
But we won.
It was a Connery film, wasn't it?
We're getting votes. In both my talkback ears, we're getting all sorts of suggestions.
Leave it with me. I'm going to look that one up.
Thought you might. Pilots waving. You'll be able to see you waving back. Shows how you can hands off. He's either that or he's cold and he's trying to warm his hands up.